As discussed in the previous video, not all firm equity belongs to common shareholders. In this video, I discussed that previously granted options and stocks to the firm managers and employees also represent claims on the equity of the firm. I also highlight how we should take into account these claims on firm equity when doing our valuation. Finally, we discuss how we should take into account the effect of different classes of shares in valuation. First, let's discuss stock-based compensation. There are two general methods that firms use for stock-based compensation: restricted stock units, or RSUs, and stock options. I discuss each of them separately and the way that we need to account for them in valuation. Restricted stock units have been the most common form of stock-based compensation during the past decade. RSUs are shares that are granted to employees but have some restrictions, mostly due to vesting schedule. Specifically, the employee is granted shares but will actually receive the shares and can trade them after a period of time, say 3 to 5 years from the granting date. The vesting period is there to incentivize the employee to continue working at the firm. While companies do have to report unvested stock grants in their filings, and while these unvested stocks do represent claims on firm equity, they are not part of shares outstanding. Therefore, if you simply divide the equity value to the number of shares outstanding while there are existing RSUs, you would overestimate the value per share for common shareholders. So, how do we deal with RSUs in valuation? Since the firm has to issue new shares when granted stocks are vested, the best and easiest way to deal with them is to consider them as part of the shares outstanding. So imagine you are valuing Facebook using discounted cash flow method. Assume that you have already computed equity value and now you need to compute per share value. For this, you should start by finding the number of shares outstanding. This is typically reported at the beginning of a company's filing. In case of Facebook, since there are two classes of shares, the sum of the two classes give you total number of shares outstanding. Then you need to check if there are stock-based compensations that could be dilutive, meaning that could dilute the value of equity owned by common shareholders. For this, you need to look for sections explaining stock-based compensation, which is typically within the notes to shareholder equity section. Here, in case of Facebook, you can see that there were 67.3 million unvested shares at the end of 2018. You need to add these shares to the number of shares outstanding to get to the total shares that take into account RSUs. Assuming that there is no other equity claim, you should divide the equity value to this total number of shares to have an estimate of value per share for common shareholders. The second form of stock-based compensation is stock options. When a manager receives a stock option as compensation, she essentially gets the right to buy the shares of the company at a fixed price in the future. When these options are exercised, the firm has to either issue new shares or buy back shares in the open market to cover the option exercise. Therefore, the higher the value of these options, the lower the equity value for current shareholders. It is important to note that when the employee exercises her options, she has to pay the exercise price to the firm in return for receiving the share. Before I explain how to account for stock options in valuation, let's go back to Facebook annual filings for 2018 to see how these options are reported. Again, these are typically reported in the stock-based compensation section, which is within the notes to shareholder equity. You can see that exercisable options at the end of 2018 amount to 1.1 million shares. Note that these are not all the same options with the same exercise price, but the weighted average exercise price for these options is reported to be $13.74. Given that the stock price at the time was $131, these are significant claims on firm equity, which does not belong to common shareholders. There are three ways that you may see people use in practice to account for existing stock options in valuation. The first and most imprecise method is to add up the number of in-the-money options to the number of shares outstanding and then divide the equity value to these total shares. In this way, stock options are treated the same way as I mentioned to account for RSUs. This method ignores the fact that when options are exercised, the option holder has to pay the exercise price to the company. In other words, this way we underestimate the value per share since we do not account for the proceeds coming from exercise of options to the company. The second and the most widely used method in practice is called treasury stock approach. This method fixes the issue I mentioned above by adding the proceeds from the exercise of in-the-money options to the equity value in the numerator. Implicit assumption in this method is that all the in-the-money options are exercised right now and any out-of-the-money option is not taken into account at all. This could be an issue with this method. Specifically, the issue is that treasury stock approach does not take into account the time premium on the options into the valuation. In other words, according to this approach, there is no difference in per value shares of a firm with no employee options and the same identical firm if it issues 1 billion at the money options to its managers, which I hope you agree that it sounds strange. I remind you that the option value comes either from its intrinsic value, which is its value if it exercised now and it's the difference between the current price and the strike price, and the time value, which is the part of the option value that comes from the fact that the option could increase in value before its expiration date. While at-the-money options have intrinsic value of zero, which means that their value is zero if they are exercised now, they do have time value. The higher the time value of the options, the higher the overestimation of value per share estimated using treasury stock approach. You may ask under what conditions the time value of options is relatively high. Well, the more time left to expiration, the larger the time value. The more volatile the stock price, the higher the time value. The third approach uses an option pricing method to estimate the market value of the existing employee options. For example, there is a modified version of Black-Scholes formula that incorporates the dilution or increased number of shares coming from the exercise of these types of options and is frequently used to estimate the value of employee options. To use such a formula, you need some variables or estimates such as stock price, volatility of the stock, strike price on the options, and the risk-free rate. When you have an estimate of the value of options, that option value is in fact a claim on the equity of the firm. Therefore, to estimate the value per share, you deduct the value of employee options from the total equity value to get to the value of equity for common shareholders. Then you divide the value of equity to common shareholders to the number of shares outstanding to get to the value per share. Note that in here, the denominator does not bring in the number of options, since the dilution effect of options are already incorporated when estimating the option value, otherwise we will be double counting. To sum up, both treasury stock approach and using option pricing are reasonable ways to incorporate the effect of employee and management options in valuation. Having said that, in situations where the time value of options represent a significant part of option value, for example, when there are many out of money or at the money options, or when the time to expiration is very long or the stock price is very volatile, the treasury stock approach may attach a too low value to the options and hence overestimate the value per share. There is one last remaining point that I would like to discuss that sometimes could be important to take into account when going from equity value to value per share. That is the issue with different classes of shares. It is becoming more and more common, particularly for tech and software companies, to have two classes of shares with different characteristics such as voting power. Facebook and Google are two most well-known examples of companies with different classes of shares. Another example is Snap, that went public in 2017 by issuing only non-voting shares. Sometimes, also, there is a class of shares in a company that is not traded, and these are usually super voting shares held by founders or top executives. Google has such a share class. So, the question is whether the value of these super voting shares, regular shares, non-voting shares, etc. are equal or not. If they all have the same value, then we can simply divide the equity value to the sum of all these shares to have an estimate of value per share. However, common sense tells us that a share with voting rights should have a higher value than an identical share but without voting rights. Indeed, on average, voting shares are typically traded with a premium. The premium, however, depends strongly to how much investors trust the management of the company. If investors trust the management and the actions and policies they take on their behalf, they may not value their voting options much and hence may not be willing to pay a large premium to buy a voting share. As a result, in such a company, the voting premium could go towards zero, which means that the voting and non-voting shares would be traded with an almost identical price. Now assume that you are valuing a company with different classes of shares and you know that there is a voting premium, for example, by observing the trading prices. In this case, compute the value per share for non-voting shares. You need to convert all shares to equivalent non-voting shares. To do so, you need to sum up the non-voting shares with 1 plus premium multiplied by the number of voting shares. For example, assume that the value of equity for the firm is 420 million. There are 50 million non-voting and 50 million voting shares outstanding. And the voting shares are traded at 10% premium. To compute the value per share for non-voting shares, you need to convert all shares to equivalent of non-voting shares. We have 50 million non-voting shares plus 50 million voting shares, each worth 10% more than a non-voting share. Then we divide the equity value to the total equivalent of number of non-voting shares to get to the value per share for non-voting shares, which is $4 in here. To obtain value per voting shares, we apply the 10% premium, which gives us the value of $4.4 per voting shares. So in this video, I discussed how to account for different types of stock-based compensation in valuation and how the existence of different classes of shares may affect our estimate of value per share.